Welcome back, everyone. In this second video on the equilibrium constant lab, I will discuss how we determine epsilon, or the molar absorptivity constant, by creating a standard curve. You will recall from the first video that to be able to get the equilibrium constant for our target reaction, one of the values we must obtain is the equilibrium concentration of our product, which is the complex ion iron thiocyanate, which has a reddish color. We will use absorption spectroscopy to find this equilibrium concentration of product by utilizing Beer's law, which is shown here. We will calculate concentration of the complex ion product by taking the measured absorbance of each mixture from table 2 and then dividing that by epsilon, which is the molar absorptivity of the sample, and L, which is the path length that the light travels, which we said is 1 centimeter. So that means the only quantity we need before we can calculate our equilibrium concentration is epsilon. The way we will obtain epsilon is by using a method called a standard curve. To understand this method, first, notice how the Beer's law equation actually has a linear form with a y-intercept of 0, y equals mx. That means if we plot absorbance on the y-axis and concentration on the x-axis, as shown in this plot, our slope should be equal to epsilon times L. That means epsilon can be calculated from the slope. So in the plot we have on the screen, slope is equal to 3,783.1833 per molar, which is equal to epsilon times L. Plugging in 1 centimeter for L, we can solve for epsilon being equal to 3.78 times 10 to the third per molar per centimeter. So to summarize, you will make solutions of the complex ions whose concentrations are known. The recipe to make these solutions are given in part B and table 3 of your lab procedure, which I show here. These solutions are called standard solutions. You will then measure the absorbance of these standard solutions in the spectrophotometer and record the values on page 9 of your lab report. You will then plot the values of absorbance against concentration and fit that data using a line equation as I show here. The slope of that line can then be used to determine your epsilon. So hopefully that sequence of steps makes sense. Now, we must first figure out how we determine the concentration of the complex ion in the standard solution. If you go back to the beginning of this video, I told you that we will calculate the equilibrium concentration of the complex ion by taking the absorbance of each mixture and dividing it by epsilon times L. But now I'm telling you that we will get epsilon by using a plot of absorbance versus concentration. The question then is, how come it is possible to get concentration for the standard solution, but we need epsilon to calculate the concentration for the test mixture? The reason is because the standard solutions have a different recipes compared to the test solutions. In the standard solutions, one of the reactants has a much smaller concentration than the other. Why does this matter? Let me illustrate this with an example. Let's say I have a reaction, A plus B goes to C. The K expression will be C at equilibrium over A times B at equilibrium. Now the ICE table for the reaction is also shown here. This merely helps us figure out that the equilibrium concentration of the reactants is going to be the initial values minus X, and X itself is equal to the equilibrium concentration of C. Now, if the equilibrium concentration of the reactants is equal to initial minus X, that means that the initial must be the equilibrium concentration plus X. That would help us later to calculate our initial concentration. Now, let's assume that K is 10 in this case. It really doesn't matter what value we choose, as we will get exactly the same conclusion. So one way we can get a K that's equal to 10 is if we have C being equal to 1 molar, A being equal to 1 molar, and B being equal to 0.1 molar. Now let's consider other combinations of concentration of A, B, and C at equilibrium that will yield a value of 10 for K. These are all listed in this table right here in the first three columns. What I can do is then work backwards to figure out what the initial concentration of the reactants will be if I have these equilibrium concentrations. Values of the initial concentration of these reactants are then shown here on the last two columns on the right. Now once you have all these numbers, we see something really interesting. Notice that when the initial concentration of A is much greater than the initial concentration of B, this is 1,000, for example, and this is 1, this is 10,000, this is 1. you find that the equilibrium concentration of C approximately the same as the initial concentration of B. So I highlight that here in these two columns. So you see how the equilibrium concentration of the product is basically the same as the initial concentration of the limiting reactant. This bears repeating with regards to our specific reaction. What it means is that if we make our initial iron concentration much higher than our initial thiocyanate concentration, then we can conclude that our equilibrium complex ion concentration will be equal to the initial thiocyanate concentration. So this is the trick that we will use to help us get the equilibrium concentration of the complex ion for our standard curve. We will mix our reactants so that the thiocyanate is the limiting reactant. You can see this in the recipe on how to make the standard solution given in your lab procedure part B. Here it says to use 0.2 molar iron nitrate and 2 times 10 to the minus 3 molar thiocyanate, which means roughly a 100:1 ratio of iron to thiocyanate. Now I'm going to show you an example calculation. So let's say you're making a standard solution from the mixture shown here. The first question is, what will the equilibrium concentration of the product B? Since the thiocyanate is the limiting reactant, that means the equilibrium concentration of iron thiocyanate, the complex ion, is equal to the initial concentration of thiocyanate. So how do we calculate the initial thiocyanate concentration? We use the dilution equation, similar to what you did in the clock reaction lab. So here are the numbers. We have 3 milliliters of the thiocyanate at 2.5 times 10 to the minus 3 molar. Okay, so that's at the top, divided by the total volume, which is 10 plus 7 plus 3 milliliter, giving us a total of 20 milliliter. And so that gives us the initial concentration of 3.75 times 10 to the minus 4. Now that happens to be your initial concentration of thiocyanate, but that also is the equilibrium concentration of the complex ion. Okay, now in your actual lab, the stock solution from part B is further diluted to make other solutions that will be used to generate the standard curve. These dilutions are shown in table 3. So let's do a follow-up calculation to the one we just did with the second question, which is, if we dilute our stock with 2 milliliter of water, what is the concentration of the complex ion? This is also another dilution calculation, except that you will use 3 milliliter of the stock times the concentration of the stock, which is 3.75 times 10 to the minus 4, divided by the total volume, 5 milliliters in this case, 3 plus 2, giving us 2.25 times 10 to the power of minus 4 molar for the diluted solution. Okay, so you will do these calculations during your lab for the stock as well as the dilution of the stock solutions. And the answers will then be entered into a table on the top of page 9, which has the title Calibration Curve Data. The absorbance values you will get from taking those solutions and measuring it inside the spectrophotometer. Now, once you've completed this table, you will plot the values in Excel and get a linear fit and slope so you can calculate your epsilon. Okay, so hopefully that clears up how we will obtain epsilon. Now the concepts in these two videos are related. So if you're a bit confused, go back to the first video and watch it again and make sure you organize these in your lab notes so you're clear on what you need to do.